Happy to have you join us today on the program Elder Living on ITV. I am Adesuwa Osa Owagie. Why Nigerians or people undermine preventive healthcare system is very much something that we need to look into. A lot of us don't like to go to hospitals or seek medical care until, you know, things have really gone bad. We have somebody in the house who is going to be talking to us on the need for us to adopt preventive healthcare in our society. He is the Chief Environmental Officer, Department of Disease Control, Ministry of Health, Mr. Frank Inenemo. It's nice to have you join us.
It's my pleasure, and thank you for the opportunity.
We're looking at adoption of preventive healthcare because we're used to rushing to the hospital when there is a crisis. We're used to running to go see a doctor when there's a problem or when the problem is almost at hand. But seeking indulging in preventive healthcare is a serious problem. We seem to undermine it. I need you to hammer on this.
Thank you very much. Universally, the healthcare system or healthcare delivery machinery is divided into three major components, parts. These component parts are complementary in their roles.
Okay.
No one part is more important than
the other. What are these parts?
We'll be looking at the curative healthcare delivery system.
Okay.
The preventive healthcare delivery system and the rehabilitative healthcare delivery system.
Okay.
The curative healthcare delivery system is hospital-based.
Mm-hmm.
We are looking at, when you say healthcare delivery system, you are talking of goods and services that are devices,
yes,
technologies that are used to solve health problems. Okay? And WHO defined health as a state of complete physical, mental, and social well-being of the individual, not merely the absence of disease or infirmity. Even when we know it is not possible to get a perfect health condition, we all strive for the optimum. That optimum we strive for gives us the capacity for everyday living. So, for example, we cannot say the hypertensive patient who is down with this terminal condition is not in health, even if he or she is relying on one supportive therapy or the other. Somebody is having ophthalmological problem. He relies on the glasses as prescribed, okay? We will not say he's not in health. He is in health, but he's having a daily, you know, capacity. He's having capacity for everyday living to survive. Now, the bane of our healthcare delivery system has been the priority placed over time on the curative. And you can only talk of curative when there is fault at the level of the preventive. If there is problem, if the preventive is okay and everything has been taken care of, you find out that if the individuals can only go to hospital when they come down with maybe diseases that are considered hereditary, that have a long family history. I want to narrow it down to our local parlance here. The average African or average Nigerian will appreciate somebody when I'm down, for example, with malaria, when I go to the hospital, I'm jabbed.
Yes.
Until I became a health worker, I did not appreciate the value of other health workers. I only see those who jab me with injection or the other, or prescribed drugs for me as the only healthcare delivery persons. Whereas somebody is there to tell you, Adesuwa, this is your premises where you live. There are overgrown weeds.
And that can
These overgrown
problems.
Weeds can allow mosquitoes to breed. These overgrown weeds can allow for rodents to hibernate. Rodents, we know, transmit a lot of diseases.
Yes.
Plague is there. leptospirosis, all these will be looked at in subsequent presentation. I'm only going to be highlighting them in this introductory session. Now, rodents, as I said earlier, is known to transmit plague, which is a disease, a disease of high internationally notifiable, whatever. You have Lassa fever. We also have leptospirosis and a number of other things that rodents cause. For example, they can damage your cable and cause those electric cables in your house to ignite, and there will be fire outbreak. They can even eat you as a human being. Apart from all that, they can cause destruction to your furniture. I'm just talking generally.
Yes.
Your waste, the garbage content of your waste. Somebody is there to tell you, ah, madam, take care of, handle these things sanitarily. Because when you handle your waste sanitarily, you will prevent hazards to man. Physical hazards, biological hazards, chemical hazards. You will also prevent pollution of the natural environment. Land pollution will be prevented. Soil pollution, which is land pollution, will be prevented. Water pollution will be prevented, as well as atmospheric pollution will also be prevented. All this comes under somebody telling you, take care of all this so that you don't come down with avoidable health care problems. Now, I said earlier, we have failed to get it right because we have continuously in this our system.
That we have failed to get the preventive.
No, we have failed to get the healthcare system right.
Okay.
Because we have continuously placed emphasis on the curative, at the expense of the preventive. I give you another example.
Well, before the example, if you want to contribute to this program, the number is 052-290-573. 052-290-573. The number is going to be on your screen shortly. We need to adopt proper way of preventing diseases. That is why we have Frank Inenemo in the house, who is, of course, the Chief Health Officer. At the Chief Environmental Officer, Department of Disease Control, Ministry of Health. Okay, give us the example.
I'll give you another example. We consume all sorts of water. Even the water we provide for ourselves now, because we are all on self-help, there is no quality control. We get this water from our private boreholes and store inside
plastic tank,
plastic containers, which is polyethylene. That again reminds me of people who are using polyethylene to make moimoi. And these things are under the intensity of the heat of the sun, day in, day out. And you cannot rule out the feasibility or the possibility that some of the chemical content, which is those plastics we emit, whether low density polyethylene or high density polyethylene, will not get dissolved inside that water. Meanwhile, nobody is controlling, doing quality control of that water.
What's the work of you guys at the Environmental and Health Department?
I said it's self-help because ideally we are supposed to be getting public water supply. That's what I said. So if there is no, who is doing, like your own, I'm sure you operate a private, where you get your source
of
water.
Everybody does. Everybody.
But what I'm saying now is, who does the quality control?
Who is supposed
to determine
who is supposed to do the quality control
of that water to
ensure that water is safe for drinking?
For human consumption.
Good. Who is supposed to do that? Who is supposed to do the quality control on such waters? Because almost everybody in this state relies on private borehole.
Well, that question will not be a question for me now.
Why?
Let me just continue with what
I'm just telling you
that there's supposed to be quality control.
I know.
So that it is analyzed and the portability and safety of that water is determined for your consumption.
Frank Inenemo, yes. I'm not going to let you off that hook.
Yes.
Who is supposed
to do this check? NAFDAC is there.
Mm-hmm.
The relevant other relevant agencies of government, Urban Water Board and all
okay,
that.
Okay, because that's what we want to know.
They are supposed to be there to check monitor, to
every
check
private borehole.
Every private borehole to be sure that whatever we have, in fact, before it is sited, some of these boreholes are even sited close to septic tank. And you cannot rule out possible infiltration underground to this borehole. And we keep on drinking this. And
so how do we prevent ourselves from getting diseases from such waters?
Those samples have to be collected and analyzed bacteriologically, chemically, and even through physical examination so that you'll be able to know that a potable water ideally is supposed to be colorless, supposed to be odorless, is supposed to be tasteless, and is supposed to be turbidity-free. Now, I said earlier that the emphasis has been on curative, and that's why we are getting this one. I give you another example. Let's look at the case of malaria. There's high prevalence of malaria in sub-Saharan Africa. There have been a lot of programs on rollback malaria. Mm-hmm. My concept of that is roll back the mosquito. Roll back the mosquitoes. And once you grow back the mosquitoes, there will be no malaria. A friend of mine just came, because they are the vectors. A friend of mine just came back from the United States. He's in town, and I want to think he might even be watching something. For the past 18 years, he doesn't know
what
is malaria. But he's in town, and he's treating for malaria. Because over there, the environment is too serene for mosquitoes to breed, apart from the fact that the climate does not support it. So we can also get the environment here. Like I said, I come to your house, the environment is filthy, overgrown with, and you have stagnant water around where the mosquitoes breed. You see me as an enemy. Ah, it's disturbing me. So it's here again. But I'm here to protect your health. I'm here to give you health education. Because health education, as it were, is a combination of learning experiences that will facilitate voluntary adaptation of behavior conducive to it, that you should endeavor that these stagnant waters are cleared off your environment and you'll be free of not having malaria and free of not being beaten by mosquitoes, which eventually translates to malaria.
There are lots of streets in Benin City. Let us use Benin City as a case study.
Yes.
There are lots of streets in Benin City where you have stagnant water. How do you expect those people to clear off that water?
I think
how would they work on it?
We can do our bit. You clear the stagnant water in your house, for example. That again has reduced some level of quantity of stagnant water in and around the environment. Your waste, the garbage content of your waste in and around your premises is taken care of. So rodents will not go there to breed. Mm-hmm. You know, rodents are highly peri-domestic.
Of course.
And they rely more on this, the garbage content of our refuse. If you can protect your food, for example, in your house very well, store and preserve properly, you find out that any rodent that mistakenly find it, will hunger will drive him or drive the rodent out.
Away.
But when there is fertile, there is enough of food. And of course, rodents, in fact, maybe subsequent presentation will talk, those creatures you see, they are terrible. We have to devote a full day to discuss about rodents.
Frank and Enema, let me take you back.
Yes.
Let me take you back to water.
Yes.
A lot of us take sachet water. Mm-hmm. A lot of us take bottled water. And sometimes when you're driving on the street, you see these trucks loaded with sachet water right there under the sun. And we've been told that heat and those pollutants don't mix.
They gradually
How do we save ourselves?
Well, it's a big problem. It's a big problem. It's a big issue. In the sense that, well, NAFDAC has come to help us to say any sachet water that is more than 2 months should not be consumed. But check those sachet water, whether you have manufactured dates on them, manufactured.
I don't think I've seen
it. You cannot. Two, most times we are in a hurry. If I were to advise, I would prefer to take the bottled one high polyethylene density that doesn't easily dissolve into the water than to go for
the sachet.
The sachet. Because the sachet is low density and quickly. Give me the, maybe on the street, quickly give me one. You don't even know whether the person who is serving you has even contaminated the cellophane. And quickly you put in your mouth and you tear and you start to drink. And then perhaps there are a lot of pathogens. It could be inside, apart from the chemical, whatever. And then you come down over time with typhoid. Because typhoid can be gotten from contaminated food, contaminated water, apart from the other aspect of fecal oral transmission. And the best you could do is to use that, your cloth, to quickly clean it and then use your teeth. And that has not removed the pathogen, if any, on the surface of that polythene containing the packaged water. Now, the healthcare system said that no one component is more important than the other. Let me look at it from the anatomy of the body. The gastrointestinal tract starts from the mouth and ends up at the other end. Let's assume the other end refused to perform its role. From the mouth, what your body doesn't require is passed as waste. Whatever is supposed to go out as waste, if the other end refused to do its own work, would that not amount to toxemia? The person would die of toxemia. That is to tell you how important. You cannot completely ascribe, nobody can take credit to say, in the national healthcare system, I take credit that I am the alone that make the alone in it to make it work. No. We are all playing complementary roles. That's why, too, in the hospital system, when a segment is on strike, the other segment cannot function properly. So these are the issues. Typhoid, we said earlier, can be mechanically also transmitted by housefly. And all these are part of the human environment, which must be controlled for us. So these are all the healthcare arrangements. Until in 1978, when there was this Alma Ata declaration of primary healthcare at the grassroots, the Alma Ata declaration does state that primary healthcare is an essential healthcare that is based on sound scientific knowledge through appropriate technology that is made universally accessible, acceptable, and affordable to everyone in the community at every stage of our development, in the spirit of self-reliance and self-determination, and gave the following as components of primary healthcare, including immunization. Because we are talking about primary preventive. As a mother, I'm sure you, when you have your baby under 9 months, you ensure that all the immunization activities for that child are completed, particularly as it borders on major childhood killer diseases, ranging from polio. In fact, you start at birth with tuberculosis, BCG, followed by oral polio, HBV, which is hepatitis B vaccine, okay, HBV1, HBV2, HBV3, then measles at 9 months. You'd also talk of vitamin A and all that. That's one of the components. And primary healthcare remains the first contact of the national healthcare system, which is subdivided into the tertiary healthcare system, the secondary healthcare system, and the primary healthcare system.
Okay.
And we also have environmental health as part of the component, because primary healthcare still remains the first contact, usually at the grassroots, at the local government level, health centers, dispensaries, and all that. It still remains the first contact of the national healthcare system. Okay, so environmental health is part of it, which talks about the control of those deleterious elements in the environment, which exercise or may exercise the deleterious effect on man's physical development, health, and survival. Okay, and then we also have provision of healthful housing. It may amaze you that the nature of our houses, the way they are built, is supposed to support healthy living. For example, where a room is not properly ventilated, a house is poor lighted, inadequately lighted, poorly lit. Okay? A house where there are no adequate sanitary conveniences. Very, very important. Maybe a house containing 10 people, you have just 2 units of latrine.
Sometimes maybe just one.
And in some cases, there are no even latrines. In some cases, I once went for a program in Akwa Ibom. The community where I stay, most of the houses, they lack latrine facilities. Of course, what becomes
of that community,
of the people, then open defecation becomes the order of the day. Open defecation with all the associated problems. Okay, so hurtful housing. And let me again talk about this latrine thing. Very important. The enclosure of our latrine, particularly those of us using water closet. Water closet. Mm. If we don't, we are not conscious of it, becomes a safe haven for pathogens, pathogenic organisms. You see that water seal? That helps to, supposed to help disconnect offensive odor from the septic tank. That helps in the siphonic action for whatever has been deposited inside. You are supposed to use your lid to cover it when you are flushing.
Okay.
Oftentimes, people leave it open.
And
it vaporizes. And as it's vaporizing, they end up around the walls. Where you touch the rim, everywhere you touch. And some people go ahead of putting their toothbrush and a cup for pasting inside the toilet. You know, most of this, the toilet, modern day toilet is bathroom and bath.
Mm-hmm.
Your toilet, toiletries, particularly with your
are
brush,
usually in the
are
bathroom.
Supposed to be in your a convenient place in your room. If you have a room that is attached or a toilet that is attached to your room and not left open, and when that lid is not in, you're supposed to be covered, except when you want to use it. Because as soon as you are flushing, that siphonic action that takes some of the water vapor, and as it's vaporizing, most of the pathogens contained there. So fecal transmission becomes the order of the day. And trust us, many of us don't even know imbibe the
culture of,
the washing, culture of hands. Washing hands. And even when we do, we don't even do properly. There are 8 to 10 steps if you want to really do correct hand washing, which take almost 5 to 10 minutes to do.
To wash
and
hands?
Yes, not less than 8 to 10 steps. Maybe off air later, I will demonstrate it.
Please,
to
you will demonstrate
and some
it
other
so
time
know.
Too, we may have to have a day for it on air to demonstrate it. So those are the issues. So we have environmental health as part of it. A supply of essential drug, oral health and dental hygiene and all that. All these are the various components. And these are, you know, again, the issues we talk about in public health. You see, I went as part of my postgraduate studies in UI. There was a professor that talked about integration in primary healthcare. And what was the concept of integration? His concept of integration. His concept of integration is that much as everyone in the healthcare delivery system is important, we are playing complementary roles. He looked forward to a situation, perhaps in Nigeria, like it's done in the Asia countries and all that, where in a hospital setting, in a hospital arrangement, you have the orthodox doctor, you have the traditional doctor, you have every other person. There's this referral thing and cross-referral, either horizontally or vertically, top-bottom or bottom-top referral approach. That is, if it's beyond me as an orthodox, and you can, what is important is for the people to get quality service delivery. That's why, according to the professor, I'm just telling you that he's a professor of medicine, Professor Asuzu. He taught me occupational health. He said that integration, there will be synergy. There's nothing secret about what I'm doing and you don't want the other one to know. Or me feeling, trying to be important than the other person. No, we are playing complementary. What is important is, at the end of the day, the patient, the client get quality. It's like in Benin parlance, they say, That is, a man sees a snake,
a
woman killed the snake. It's provided the snake died. Mm. It doesn't mean that anybody must. It's like, again, this is your office.
Frank, let me take your mind to something I've noticed in our environment.
Yes.
You know, when we had this issue of Lassa fever, Ebola, and all of that, when you go to public places, you find this bucket that we named Ebola buckets.
Okay, for hand washing.
For hand washing. Yes. You see people going there, oh, I need to wash my hand. But for a very long time now, when you go to such places, you go to public places, you go to some schools, you don't find these buckets anymore.
You know,
is it that we have completely eradicated this out of our system? Because not too long ago, we heard that there was an outbreak somewhere close to Nigeria, not in Nigeria, but in a country close to Nigeria. And we also heard that there was Lassa fever somewhere not too long ago. Why is it so difficult for people to adopt or to sustain preventive measures?
Well, there is usually your sister program on Man Around Town. Somebody will say a wise man is proactive and a foolish man is reactive.
Reactive.
Somebody said it in this security tip.
Mm-hmm.
You see, issue of, you see, until there's an outbreak, this fire brigade thing will not happen.
That is the problem.
How many of us know that rodents are not supposed to be part of our environment at all, close to us?
I've heard people say that if you do not have rodents in your house or around your house, that means there are snakes there. So that's why people just allow it.
If you do not have, or if you
have. Yes, if you do not have.
No, if you
that
have,
means there are snakes that are eating up the rodents.
Okay, okay. No, that is not a good.
Okay, let's quickly take this call. Hello. 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 Hello.
Hello.
Okay, let's just continue until the caller is ready.
Yes, you see.
Okay, hello. Hello.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon. Please tell us your name and ask
your
question. Good afternoon. What's your name, please?
Hello.
Hello. Good afternoon.
Good
I can
afternoon.
Hear you.
Please, I want to talk to Mr. Frank in a minute.
Okay, please go ahead.
Hello. Are you with
Hello.
Me?
Go ahead with your question for Frank in Enemo.
Can you hear me?
I can hear you.
Okay. Mr. Frank, thank you very much for your program. It's very, very much educative and enlightening.
Thank you very much.
You made mention about the steps in washing hands.
Yes.
Can you quickly just give us a rundown on those steps?
Oh, the steps of washing hands.
Hello?
Okay.
Okay, we can do that.
I heard you.
Did you hear me?
Yes, I did.
The steps of hand washing.
The steps in what 10 steps you made mention in washing hands.
Okay, we can quickly do that, Mr. Frank.
Okay.
At least I know a lot of people will be interested.
Okay. Okay.
All right, thank you, caller.
In hand washing, the steps are these.
Okay.
First and foremost, you need running water. Not just water in a container.
Water running from the tap or the improvised.
You need liquid soap.
Not tablet soap.
And so, if we are to take the steps, like I mentioned earlier, you see my palm like this. You do like this, you wash. You do like this, you wash. You come to the back.
To the back.
You take
wash.
Again like this.
Both
you
hands.
Wash both hands. You wash. Then you go to each of the fingers again.
You
take each one, both hands, again, both hands. After doing that, you come to the web of your fingers again. You wash. Then you go again, you see the tip of the finger.
Mm-hmm. You use it to scrub.
You scrub again. I wouldn't know the number, how many steps now, but I know I've gone more than 4 or 5 steps.
Yeah.
You take again, you do it again like this.
Mm-hmm.
Then you come again, you take again like this. You take again like this on both hands.
Mm.
And then, most importantly, your wrist.
Okay.
That wrist you see is a reservoir for most of the germs, both airborne and all that. You wash and then finally you rinse. That gives you thorough hand washing.
Okay.
And for crying out loud, The most unhygienic practice I have witnessed, that I want to say is aesthetically undesirable, is the use of water for anal cleaning. It's most hygienically unsafe, and most people practice it as if it's very good. It's the worst. In fact, one of the rules of hygiene is that there should be no handling of fresh feces. So for anybody that is using water and bare hands for anal cleaning, you are just practicing fecal oral transmission of disease from excremental matter to mouth.
Even when you wash your hands properly, as you have shown us?
There should be no, because the pathogens contained in those listings, when they find their way through the GIT, which is the gastrointestinal tract, at the end of the day, they become pathogenic in certain circumstances.
So what's the best?
So tissue the paper? Best is to use your toiletries and then wash your hands. And I said earlier just now that you are...
But you know that sometimes when you use the tissue, you don't get cleaned enough.
I don't agree with that.
Hello, good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Tell us your name and ask your question, please. Hello?
Hello?
Reduce the audio level on your TV set or move away from there and then ask your question. Okay, Mr. Frank, let's go on.
Yes, like as I was saying.
But just another way. Please, when you want to call us, endeavor to reduce the audio level on your TV set or you move away completely from where your television is so that we can hear you properly. Thank you.
Yes.
Okay, we have another call. Hello? Hello? Hello?
I think there's network problem this afternoon.
Well, the lines may be down. We have another call. Hello, caller. Yes, good afternoon.
Hello.
Please tell us your name and ask your question, please.
Hello,
I can hear you.
Hello.
How
are you?
I'm fine. And you?
Afternoon.
Good afternoon. Please ask your question. What's your name?
Online,
can you reduce the audio level on your TV set, please?
Mr. Bedi online.
I can't hear you properly because your TV set...
Please, I want the man to really tell us how can we control the
ask your question.
How can we make it the
okay, we will not be able to take your call because your TV set, the audio on your TV set is very loud. Okay, let's go on, Mr. Frank. Okay, hello. Hello?
How can we really make it secure?
I can't hear you. Hello?
Yeah, it's borehole water. The water in the borehole, because it was something of that borehole water is not also clean enough, that there should be a control. There should be a control. We should be really actually mentioned those people to control it. Then if there are not people to control it, how can the individual really make it clear?
Unfortunately, I just couldn't hear you.
I couldn't get you.
I'm sorry. So if you're going to call us again, please, you will reduce the audio level on your TV set. Hello, good afternoon. Hello? Please reduce the audio level on your TV or you move away from where your TV is.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
This is my second question. I just want to hear the request. I didn't see my name. I'm calling from Lagos. My request from Mr. Frank is, can he give me his contact, how I can get in touch with him after the program?
Okay, all right. So get in touch with Mr. Frank. Okay, you call us again. We will let you know. If it pleases him, he can call his number on air.
Hello?
If it pleases him. Okay, so let's go.
The network is bad.
Okay. If it pleases Mr. Frank, he will call his number. All right, Mr. Frank, let's continue. because it seems a lot of people are quite interested in the toilet issue and, of course, the sachet water thing. You know, because everybody takes sachet water. Either on the go, as you said, everywhere, anywhere. With the recent blackout in most places, people cannot even pump water in their areas. So they rely on sachet water. They rely on sachet water.
Even people with their
and I'm sure a lot of them are heartbroken now.
Even
because
people with their private bubble may not even want to drink their bubble.
A lot
they
of people
want
don't
to rely on
sachet water.
Bottle, table. Hello? Let me use the word table.
Hello, good afternoon.
Hello, good afternoon, ma'am.
Good afternoon.
Yes, ma'am. Please, I want to ask the man there because at the initial point of his own analysis,
you know what? If you reduce the audio level on your TV set, or you move away completely from where your television is, we will be able to hear you. There is no way you can be talking to us. I want to hear your voice at the same time. So we just have to let you go. All right, Mr. Frank.
I asked him who actually explained that carefully.
I cannot hear you properly. We're sorry about that. Please, when you want to call us, reduce the audio level. In fact, turn down the volume for your television. Come up the volume, pata pata. Or better still, go to another place. Move away from where your television is and ask your question. Hello, good afternoon, caller. Good afternoon, how are you?
I'm fine.
Okay, tell us your name and ask your question.
My name is Okokori.
Okay.
I want to ask how you can prevent water from boiling.
How you can prevent what?
Water.
Okay, you can make your water safe.
Yes.
Okay, for drinking.
Yes.
All
okay,
right.
What kind of, what's the source of that water? What is the source? Is it a water from a well or storage in an underground tank?
Underground tank.
Okay, underground tank. Okay,
yes.
That is what you do is you dug a pit and you render it watertight and then you store water inside from external, not that the water wells from underground.
No, it's underground tank.
It's underground tank.
Okay.
I want to get it clear so that I know how to articulate your answers properly.
Okay. So it's underground.
Okay.
Are you talking of underground storage tank of water?
Yes.
Okay, good. And the source of that water is through tanker and rain, I guess. Huh?
Okay, just answer the question because the person is left
in the
now.
Case of underground tank. Well, I started by saying that you have rendered it watertight, rendering the surrounding walls impervious, possibly using cement mortar. Okay, and that is allowed to project above the surrounding soil surface to about
sorry.
to about 3 to 4 feet in height above the surrounding ground level. Then you must cover it. That is basic. The roof on top may either be concrete or use of corrugated iron sheet. And then there is a space to it. Then 4 feet around that projected what you call parapet wall from within
from the
base up, what we call parapet wall, is again rendered impervious and in a way slopy so that whatever is the wastewater that splashes when you use your watering can to fetch from the underground tank does not recontaminate what is there. And over and above all, what is more important is that at regular intervals of not less than within 3 to 6 months, samples of that water is taken for chemical analysis and bacteriological analysis to determine the bacterial quality
in that
and the
water.
Chemical quality of that water.
So is that water good for drinking or do they have to boil before they drink?
That's why I said analysis. So that
how
would tell
how many people have the time to do all that?
Is it about having value for your life and value for your health?
How many of them have this information?
So that's what I'm saying. So you must be able to, at intervals, get the lab people
to come over.
To come over to take samples and go analyze. But if you can be boiling, fine.
Okay. All right, we'll pick this call now. Hello, caller. Good afternoon. Can you reduce the audio level on your TV set, please?
Hello, good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Please, I want to ask, I'm directing a question to the fans directly. Please, I want to ask, water from the borehole, do you see for drinking without treating it?
If water from the borehole is what?
It's safe for drinking without treating it.
Okay, if water from the borehole is safe for drinking without...
If properly sighted...
What I'm trying to say is that water from the borehole is safe for drinking without treating it.
Okay.
The answer is yes and no. Because if properly sighted, you take consideration that it's not close to where a septic tank is located.
A septic tank, that is your soccer well now.
Or your pit latrine is located. Again, if it's properly sighted or uppermost to any of these, considering the distance, it can be so considered safe. But you still need to do the bacteriological and chemical analysis to determine the quality and safety and potability of that water. Because incidence of kidney problems, incidence of cancer,
yes,
is on the increase. I may not be able to give you a die-hard statistics now, but it's on the increase daily as a result of the consumption of so many of these things. And we may not know that we are doing all these things, we are consuming them, we are taking for granted that they are safe. It's like somebody now who, for example, is using microwave, okay, and you expose your food. The electromagnetic wave that food you put inside that microwave is absorbing, and you want to eat it, you say, I don't eat my food
cold.
Can be dangerous.
So you must cover your food when you're microwaving.
Beautiful. You put your food in the fridge or freezer. Well, for a long time now, I've not had light in my area, so I don't even talk of preserving food in fridge or freezer.
Yes.
It must be covered because the ozone gas contained in that fridge does not help. It could have preserved the food, but it does not help matters in your health, to your own health. So all these are precautions, because preventive healthcare, prevention is not only better, it is said that it is also cheaper than cure. Consider the man-hour losses that will be saved when you pay attention to preventive healthcare. And you may need little or no hospital attention, apart from certain other conditions that are
hereditary. Proper preventive measures.
I told you somebody said he has not known what is malaria. It's treated for malaria.
For 18 years.
Yes, now. Because the environment is too serene
yes.
for mosquitoes to breed. And a whole lot. Okay. Let's look at food, for example. The standard of food hygiene. Maybe from the source of our meat, everyone is talking about protein, getting protein from meat and all that. Protein, the sources of protein from meat. Look at our abattoir. Sometimes I'm astonished.
And even the way
see the way they carry it in open wheelbarrow, sometimes caravans and all that. And
in
these things are
rickety vehicles.
Even before that, who would have inspected those live cows, what we call anti-mortem inspection, thoroughly, and would have passed it for slaughtering? Has it been properly anti-mortem, anti-mortem inspection done? After the anti-mortem inspection, it was supposed to have been followed by a post-mortem inspection.
Yes.
And we have private, I'm told even in Cameroon here, you can't go and buy ordinary fowl in the market.
All right, Mr. Frank, time is really not our friend on the program, and we're sorry we cannot take more calls because we're going to end the program now. So the importance of adopting serious and proper preventive measures, just in a minute.
Prevention is not only better, but cheaper than cure. Mm. And the only way for us to get it right in the healthcare system is to ensure that preventive healthcare, utmost priority is placed
on preventive healthcare. We shouldn't wait until we are quarter to
so
go before.
Rather than rolling back the malaria, we should roll back the mosquitoes, which is part of the preventive healthcare.
All right, people. Prevention, they say, is better than cure. Mr. Frank, you want to call your number on air for the purpose of those who want to reach you, or we'll make it private?
I think I'll prefer to make it private.
Okay, private. So you call me later, and then I'll pass the phone number to you. Thank you very much for being part of the show, Mr. Frank Enemo. We'll definitely be here again to conclude what we have started today. We'll see you again next week. Until then, please do not forget that prevention is better than cure. Bye-bye.